On this week's episode of the DevOps Lab, we're going to be talking about Terraform and deploying AKS into Azure with some added bonus of GitHub Actions. So tune in. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We're back with HashiCorp, and we're going to welcome a very special guest, Taylor Dolezal. Taylor, welcome.
Howdy. How's it going? Happy to be here.
Great. Happy to have you here. Happy to have Hashi back and talk about some really cool stuff. So tell us before we get started, what is it you do for Hashi?
So I work for HashiCorp as a senior developer advocate, mostly focused on all things infrastructure. So that's mostly Terraform, Packer, Waypoint, and definitely sneak Kubernetes in there from time to time, which you might see a little bit of today. You'll definitely see today.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, very much looking forward to this. So today we're going to talk about deploying Kubernetes into Azure with Terraform using some CI/CD, I believe. So take it away for us, Taylor.
Absolutely. So let me go ahead and bring up my screen and I will get right to it. All right, fantastic. So this is my GitHub repository. I'm going to just quickly touch on some of the things that we're going to be using today, namely GitHub Actions. As you write your Terraform code, you definitely want that feedback loop as you're writing things, right? So today I have a super linter. Thank you, GitHub, for working on that project and making things really nice as we get things committed and pushed up. Really is helpful for as PRs are open as well, which we'll take a look at shortly. And then a code quality step for Terraform. So that's the GitHub component of this. Let's go ahead and switch over to the to my VS Code instance and just take a walk through the code. So what I'm doing, I have not stood anything up. So what I'm going to actually do is run a Terraform apply, and then I'm actually going to walk through the code. So we're going to race the code. I'm going to explain it, and then we'll walk through everything in the Azure portal here. Wicked. So and also say hello to the cow. It's used to tell me my fortune, but I like the hello there a little bit better. So
does the cow have a name?
Not yet. I like when it moves out of the view. It means that I'm getting some work done for the day.
Awesome. Love it.
Fantastic. I'll go ahead and hide my terminal. This will kick off and we'll check in on that in just a little bit. Mm-hmm. So what is this project? So I'll go ahead and share the link out here in a bit, but this project is a way in which you can stand up AKS, Azure Kubernetes Service, in Azure, and then using Terraform to glue all the pieces together. So first off, I set some variables, namely project name, region, where do we want to stand this up? I live in Los Angeles, so I've picked the West US as a place to put this, to stand up this cluster. We want to set our version as well, right? When we're setting Kubernetes versions, we probably want to use near the latest. So in this case, I'm using 1.22. I was a release lead for Kubernetes 1.19, so it pains me to not put that 1.19 in there, but as all good things, software must move forward.
Absolutely.
Lastly, I'm going to go ahead and add a CIDR block as well, because, right, we want to give this an IP space to operate within. Next up, when you're working with Terraform, it's really important to pin your versions. The reason being is that while we could have, you know, less than or greater than or equal to, I always like to pin things directly to that version because then it's a lot more intentional as I go about standing up all of my dependencies and all of my infrastructure. Surprises are great, but typically for birthdays, not so much with infrastructure. I like to keep infrastructure nice and boring. So I've gone ahead and put all of these versions in here. Now, you'll note that I have set a remote backend, and I'm using Terraform Cloud for that. When I watched Kelsey Hightower give a presentation at HashiConf 2017 before I joined HashiCorp, one of the things that he made note of was always use your company's cloud. And so that's what we're doing here. I've named that workspace AKS in action. And I'll talk to those things here just in a little bit as I get to them. Terraform comes with this concept of a lock file as well. So not too much that you need to really pay attention to here. You'll never need to change this manually, but this is really nice for pinning those versions and making sure that everything is signed correctly and sourced correctly as well.
Cool.
Next up, resource groups. So typically, as I've worked with different teams around Azure, the Azure resource group is something that is a little bit different than most clouds. So we have this ability to kind of put everything into almost a nice binder and a way to visualize all the things pertinent to that resource group. So here in this instance, I'm actually going to be creating one, but we could extend this later on in the future and source a resource group if you already have one. So that's absolutely what I've gone ahead and done there, which is pretty nice. The Azure provider. So as you work with Terraform, you have to choose a provider, and then that gives you access to resources. So if we had the GitHub provider, we could instantiate repositories or set branch protection rules, things like that. It's almost like picking, you know, if you play Dungeons and Dragons or anything like that, it's like picking a class, and then you can pick all the spells and operations and fun things to do as a different way to think about it. Next up, we're going to be using some Terraform modules today, and these are public modules. So I actually sourced these from the Terraform registry, which I'll go ahead and jump over to here quickly just to give you an idea of what that looks like. First, we're going to want to stand up a network in Azure. So I'll go ahead over here. This is the Terraform registry. So registry.terraform.io, if you're curious. And then you can go ahead and search for all kinds of things. So if I type in network, I can actually see that, hey, Azure has a network module. You can read about, you know, what does it take to actually, what are the inputs for this? What are some outputs? What are things that I get after I've stood this up? And truly, truly useful on this front. So, you know, I also use the Azure AKS module as well, which I'll talk to you here shortly. And you can see there's quite a few more inputs available to you. Same thing with outputs as well. And then you can actually page through here. This is really good for documentation as well. So if we go to Azure, we can take a look and see, you know, what's the documentation? What are some resources that I might want to use or interact with as well? So you got Fuzzy Search. And then you can see what the latest version is, and they have some nice use provider button, you know, some really nice functionality here to be able to make quick work of that. So that is everything on the Terraform registry.
And I would say over the past 2.5 years, that documentation has massively improved. It's easy to use. You pull out everything you need. And I know you're using VS Code as your IDE. Anytime you're writing and using IntelliSense, it also helps fill that out for you. So it's between the two of those, like, I no longer write bad code when I'm writing Terraform. So it's made my life so much easier. So I love seeing how great the Hashi documentation is these days.
I absolutely love it. And, you know, people talk about, you know, superhero or villain origin stories and all these movies. Those are really popular, but I kind of feel like a superhero myself as I go to use these things, especially with GitHub Copilot. I have typed in comments and other things and been thoroughly surprised at what comes up on that front, especially even some light trolling when I go to put in comments and things like that, they'll get a good chuckle from. So awesome. always fun to use that front. You'll note that in this repository, I've gone ahead and tried to comment out areas that you might want a little bit more clarification. So if you're using VS Code, you can go ahead and click into each of these links, and it will show you more documentation on that front too. Cool. So network, we need a place to put this Kubernetes cluster, right? So we're going to use this network module. And you can see that I'm sourcing in some variables here. You'll note that I'm using this concept of locals for Terraform, which is in Terraform core. It's core part of the language. Locals are really helpful when you need to compute or you need to kind of change things in some capacity when it comes to Terraform variables. Say that you have a CIDR and you need to do some operations on it like I'm doing here and make a new subnet. You can do that here.
Awesome. Good to see that news and well explained.
Thank you. It's it's locals, but it shouldn't be just, you know, concentrated within your team knowledge to be able to make sense of that. It's really helpful too for being able to just have a singular variable or kind of reduce that complexity as well, which is just quite nice.
Cool.
I'll go ahead and I think I might have lost my screen. Awesome.
It's back.
When it comes to, there's coyotes outside my window right now. So there are two more components that we'll highlight here. One is the Kubernetes provider. So I'm not going to be standing up anything besides the Kubernetes cluster today, but you can use this Kubernetes provider and instantiate config maps or deployments or other things on that front, resource limits, et cetera, for your cluster. So know that you can do that. And what's really nice is I'm able to authenticate with the cluster using this data lookup as well. So I can take a look at the Kubernetes cluster, get the configuration, et cetera, and that is finally defined in this AKS-TF file. You can see that we're using the AKS module that we highlighted earlier, and then setting all these things. I'm also setting auto scaling to true because I don't want the product manager to ask, does this scale, and not be able to answer that authoritatively. So yes, this does scale up to 10 machines. So we should be, I think that's okay, at least for our proof of concept, right?
Absolutely. All right.
Good.
It's better than one.
It's just like, that's what I always say, you know, just because we have the budget, let's stress test it a little bit.
Let's do it.
All right. So we have stood everything up, which is fantastic. I will while I'm waiting to get these credentials, it'll just take a moment. It won't take too long whatsoever. I'll jump into Terraform Cloud really quick and show you how I did these things behind the scenes. The thing I like about Terraform Cloud is that you can share this out with your team and you can set workspace variables. So all of the secrets that I've set, these are write only. So I can't actually see them. I could go and edit and then just, you know, patch that and put something new in or delete it. But this is a really nice way to interact and work with your team, kind of like GitHub secrets where you can put it in and it's obscured. So you don't have to share out private information with anyone and they're just able to have it as they want to run it. The run that I triggered actually happened in the cloud. Terraform Cloud has its own runners, again, similar to GitHub Actions in that regard. So we can see that this plan went up and our apply finished. So we could see everything went up all right. And then this actually allows me to take a look at the Terraform state as well. So I could actually go here and see what changed, what got added. This was a complete recreation of a cluster. I've tested this code before, so it's been deleted and recreated quite a few times. And then Terraform Cloud does give you that ability to see, you know, what's the average plan and apply durations. How many times did I make a mistake? You know, Pobody's nerfed, so I get a nice counter reminding me of that
fact. But it's good to know that when you do fail, you have traceability in there, right? So you've really showed off a really good way to hold your code, deploy your code, test it, run it, and have that full traceability end to end, which is awesome.
Exactly. Some ways to kind of help safeguard you from that as well are these GitHub actions that we've included too. So I'll go ahead and hide. Oops, go ahead and hit the right hotkeys. There we go. The two things that we talked about initially, the superlinter. So this is something that I can use to actually format my Terraform code and just make sure everything looks okay. It's nice, and I like using it with different teams as well, because then it kind of shows people what it's setting the expectation, right? Yes. And then if people get that immediate feedback. It's yes. Great. I love it. It makes it fun. You know, I love a good Zoom session or Teams or talking with people. But sometimes getting the GitHub action feedback is cool too. We also have Dependabot supported within this repository, which is fantastic. I think I actually have a reminder here to check on some pull requests so we can actually see we have, and then I can check and see why this failed. I think everything is fine, but the reason this is failing is actually a good one. So we can see that my resources and dependencies are a little bit outdated. That should be okay, definitely okay for today's demo, but let's go in and actually see what's going on. One thing I like that Dependabot does is it gives you that, what changed, and I can immediately
What it changed and what's the vulnerability, and they also risk assess it. Is it low, medium, or high as well?
It's so fantastic. I have this set as daily on most of my repositories, but I think weekly is a more realistic picture.
Yeah, I go weekly. Daily is a bit intense, but I go weekly. But again, a lot of my repositories where I'm building stuff like this it's not life threatening. But yeah, I have a lot of customers that will run it daily because they are, deploying to the cloud every day to their production, big environments, and they could be in the financial sector, healthcare sector, et cetera, or any sector in the business. And they need to have that enterprise kind of grade functionality.
It's nice. And you have those features too with GitHub as well, right? With that ability to auto merge. So if you do have a really good testing suite, or if you have that confidence, or like you said, it's just a demo or just something to express an idea, You can go ahead and set that up in that way. So we could actually see why this failed. So it looks like SuperLinter was okay. So all the formatting was okay. And then as we can see in this Terraform init, we could see that, hey, we don't have a token to actually log into Terraform Cloud. So definitely something for me to check out here after the session. Pretty quick update on that front. So I've seen it do this for the versions within that Terraform lock file as well. Sometimes you'll need to specify that upgrade and basically let it know that it's within the right range of supported dependency semantic versioning. So that's also another thing that's worth taking note of. All right. So let's jump back into our console, and we can see that I've already stood up a cluster before. So I have that Kubernetes config in there. I'll bump up this a little bit. So I can actually go ahead and get my nodes. So I like to use Kubernetes shorthand. So this is like kubectl. This is akin to typing this out. But you don't have to type it like that. You can actually just put, I've aliased kube control to k and then get nodes. So no. And then we can actually see we have that one machine there. If we were to introduce a lot of load to that machine, that would obviously scale up to at least 10 machines and then scale in once that's all done too. So we can actually see just standard namespaces here, nothing too special. And then to put to visually show that to you, we'll go ahead and close out today with showing you our cluster that is ready for action. Depending network connection, because that's always a fun one. They just installed fiber here recently, so I'll get that dropping out from time to time. So, okay. So we can see that here is our cluster. I can actually click into it, and then we can introspect the cluster, take a look at logging and a whole bunch of other things as well. So that makes for quite a good time. You can take a look at the configuration and, again, logging, everything else like that. But that is Terraform, Azure, GitHub Actions, and a few other features in the process. And thank you for coming along today on that journey to kind of see what that's all about. And really curious to hear if you have any other questions or if there's anything else that you'd like to see. Definitely want to create that create that experience and have some fun conversations on that front.
Thank you everyone for tuning in today. And thank you, Taylor, for joining us on the show for talking about Terraform and deploying AKS Azure, one of my favorite topics, and showing us this full end-to-end solution. It was awesome. So thank you. And for everyone that watched, we're going to put some notes down here in the show notes. You can comment, ask questions. Myself and Taylor will be able to respond to you. So thank you everyone for tuning in, and see you next time on the DevOps Lab.